This is the United States of America, the mainland with its 48 states, not including Alaska or Hawaii. Between 2006 and 2009, I lived in the USA, in South Carolina. That's this state here. But when it was time to come home, I found myself in the fortunate position of being able to spend time and money to travel around the rest of the country, visiting all the other states. My route decided by the fact that in each of those 48 states, I had to visit a town or a place that shared the name as a stop on the London Tube map. We called it Underground USA. In 2006, I'd moved to the USA to settle down. But 3 years later, when it hadn't worked out and I found myself single again, I decided that I wanted to see the whole of the country that I'd lived in for a time before heading home. Initially, I'd considered just a coast-to-coast road trip, something that many people do. But this soon expanded into visiting every single state in America, and in each of those states, find a place that shared the name as a stop on the tube map. Oh, and also, I'd visit some of the classic tourist sites along the way as well. So I plotted a route, bought a tent, asked friends to accompany me for legs of the route, and then prepared to set off in a Jeep Cherokee loaned to me by my housemate Beverly.
So here's the thing. You were giving me a ride. I was going to sell my car. Is that correct?
Right.
And but before I could sell my car, because I crashed it twice this year, I had to go and get it repaired. So that I could then sell it privately to make money to then buy a vehicle to travel around in. And you were actually giving me a ride back to the rental car. Because I had to then get a rental car whilst my car was being repaired, right?
Right.
This sounds more convoluted than it is, but basically then Beverly turned around and said, or you could just borrow my car. Is that how it worked? This is where you speak.
That's how it worked.
So here's the plan we came up with, is that Beverly would take my car for the summer, and I would then, we would swap. I'll be back in 2 months. See ya. This is it. This is what I'm going to be traveling around the USA in for 8 to 10 weeks of my life. You need to wash. Beverly, can we?
The trip started on the 15th of June, and every day I tweeted my progress along with writing my blog, taking photos and recording video, which I would then edit whilst on the road and post to that blog every few days. You're seeing some of the clips from those first 2 weeks on screen now, only in a smaller window, and that's because 2 weeks into the trip, I'd been to 13 states and therefore 13 places, when I'd got to Greensboro, North Carolina, only to have my car broken into and all my equipment stolen. Which means the only video I have from the first 2 weeks of my trip were the lower resolution clips that I'd already uploaded to my website. Amazingly, back in my American home of Charleston, South Carolina, people and friends rallied round, and they started a fundraiser to pay for replacement equipment, primarily a new high-quality video camera so that I could carry on filming and continue on with the trip. I did, though, still have a smaller, lesser-quality camcorder, which I used to record a painful-to-watch video detailing my predicament. And that is where we start, the morning after the robbery. Word got out of the robbery, and a reporter from a local paper turned up to talk to me.
What happens is that we've been on the road every day. You've been lugging stuff in and out. And we're here for 2 nights. We're going to stay here like last night and tonight. So I got back and I've been driving all day. It's like, oh, just go inside, grab a beer. And I just got lazy and didn't bring it up and stuff. Primarily what I think happened is that I left the GPS on.
The story appeared in the paper and online the next day. But more amazingly, the Help Jeff campaign page, created by my friends Dan, Chris and Ken back in Charleston, had raised almost $4,000 for me, meaning that I could order up a replacement camera and video camera, and my trip could continue. The same day, Katie flew back to Charleston, but weirdly, an old colleague called Melissa, who lived nearby, had seen my story in the paper and came to meet me when I went to the glass shop to get the window repaired.
One of the main reasons I have to go back to Charleston after the trip has ended is because Melissa's getting married.
I'm not getting married in Charleston.
No, but it's like, you know, I have to bring Beverly's car back. And she's like, Jeff, you have to come back to South Carolina because I'm getting married. When are you getting married again? September 13?
That's right.
So I've got to video your wedding with my video camera that's been stolen.
I thought about that. I was like, oh, I hope he comes up with
good luck with
camera.
That. Yeah. So she's using my backup camera right now. And I'm trying to get the woman in the glass shop to sign my t-shirt. I think she should put, sorry you were robbed.
Sorry, you were wrong. In North Carolina.
But it should have been $235, and then she saw that I was in the paper. Mm-hmm. And she
Show us the paper.
I know, which, where's the paper?
What page are you on?
A4.
Yes, sir.
There
he is. FIFA sent back to blogger's trip across the US.
What's this theft?
Oh, sorry, sorry.
It's been a long day.
It has been a long day.
So you're going to do this? You can turn off.
Sure.
So what you need to do is put a blob. First of all, you pick a colour. Choose your colour.
Choose your colour. Well, we don't want deep blue and state red. You don't have a Carolina blue, so we'll just go with green.
So then you put a little blob in North Carolina where green is. So it's kind of in here somewhere.
Right.
Where
about
be?
There.
Where would it be? Yeah.
And then
put today's date, which is
the 30th, 6:30:09,
and you can promote your business. Ben's Wanger Glass.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Better luck. Don't leave your equipment in your car.
One window fully repaired, it was time to hit the road again.
It's a window.
Show us again how it goes up.
So the closing shot should be the window. Ready?
I wanted to head for my American home in Charleston immediately and recover over the weekend and buy a new computer and video camera. But I had a stop to visit on the way, Hampstead in North Carolina, where I got some shaky shots using my backup camcorder.
This is Hampstead. Basically a crossroads with a CVS and a Food Lion, like most other towns in America. The sky's pretty though.
I spent the 4th of July weekend in Charleston, where I bought a new computer, new stills camera, and ordered a new video camera, which I would pick up in New Orleans a week later. I recuperated for a couple of days, and then, with my new companion JJ for the week, we headed north to Woodford, a small nothing town, and then so west to Atlanta, where the car developed a fault.
This is JJ. Who let you drive?
What?
Who let you drive?
I don't know.
Jeff knows how to brake cars.
I know how to brake cars. JJ knows how to fix them, and today he's fixing my engine coolant. I'm so thrilled.
Now, the car shop was about a 30-second walk away, but JJ had plans to drive there.
Where are you going?
Go to an event.
It's JJ, it's just there.
So?
We're gonna walk, right? You're not gonna drive. It's right there. Why would you drive?
Because it's right there.
Americans, it seems, really do like to drive everywhere.
Mix with any color. Goes into anything.
I'm so glad you know this.
Yeah.
Engine coolant bought. I did the manly thing. I videoed JJ filling the car up.
Thanks, JJ.
You're welcome.
We spent the night in Atlanta at my friend's Russell's house. I got him to sign my t-shirt as I was trying to get one person per state to write something. And the next day, we were going to be able to visit two same name places in a day. But before we could do either of those, we stopped at
a giant chicken. This is the KFC.
Now, once you've seen the world's largest chicken, the next obvious stop is to go and see the world's largest chair, which is exactly what we did. Straight after that though, we went to Temple, which was our first same name stop for the day, a nice small town that even had a railway running through it, but yet the trains didn't actually stop there. I was starting to feel like the same name places we were visiting always had railways in them, even though that was not part of the plan. And yet, when we then went to Brompton, our next same name stop, look what we found. Trains are always exciting to see, right?
We got to see a train!
I know, I like trains.
I'm very excited.
It's another train. It's the second train today.
We headed south along I-65 past Birmingham, Alabama, and then headed for Tallahassee in Florida along US Highway 231, which is a seemingly never-ending road full of chain shops and restaurants. We made Florida before nightfall and checked into a hotel for the night. The next morning, we visited the same named stop of Lancaster, only to find that it was a barren crossroads in the middle of a forest of pine trees. Lots of places were turning out to be crossroads with not much there, which is fine, because at least I could say I'd been. And then, still using my poorer quality backup video camera, we headed west to New Orleans to meet a friend of mine, Tammy, who's a police officer.
We're in New Orleans. New Orleans. New Orleans. Whatever. There's a big fucking truck behind me. And I gotta change lanes now. Get out of the way, big fucking truck. There we go. And at the end of ramp 235 should be our police escort. That's gotta be her, right?
Yeah, I'm sure. It's a gold police car.
How do you know it's a police car?
What do you mean, how do I know it's a police car?
It's got a little light in the back. I think we found her. Hello? How the hell did we get out? How the hell are you? We made it.
Hi.
Tammy, JJ. This is all on video.
Okay, hi.
I just touched your butt, sorry.
That's okay.
Right. Tammy works as a police officer and takes us to the call center where all incoming 911 calls are received.
They've given me a dispatch radio. I'm going to steal it and take it back to Charleston so that I can avoid speeding tickets.
I'm telling you,
I'm sorry.
Got a headset.
Can hear 911 calls coming in. Someone's car's been broken into, hey, like me.
I spent the weekend in New Orleans, where annoyingly my new video camera did not turn up. But with JJ now leaving me and going back to Charleston, something, or rather someone, that did turn up was my unexpected new companion for the week, my mum.
It's Tuesday the 14th of July. I'm using my little mini backup video camera where you have to shout loudly so that the audio gets picked up. That's the disadvantage of the backup video camera. We're in Memphis, Tennessee, although technically we're in West Memphis, just over the state line in Arkansas. Memphis sort of spreads and we're here to do Elvis. We, by the way, is me and my mum, and there's a shot of my mum right now. Operating the video camera, who's joined me for this week up to Chicago, which hasn't gone great because my video camera saga continues and I've spent all morning sat on the laptop for an hour trying to organize a new camera, trying to find a place that will supply one and sell me one and the right price and the right delivery date, and it's been a nightmare. I think I've done it.
Buying the new video camera had turned into a huge saga, but I did eventually have one on order which I hoped might be delivered to the campground tomorrow. That meant, in the meantime, we had time to go and visit Graceland.
It cost $10 to park, and then the woman said you can't bring your video camera inside, only your stills camera. So, no actual video inside Graceland, folks.
Which was fine, because the next day, something rather exciting happened.
This is a site.
I bring presents every day. We're like Santa Claus.
I'd got my good quality video camera back, and that was the last piece to be replaced in everything that had been stolen.
Right, I promise not to get this one stolen. I swear. Oh, you get free tape. That is essentially it. But by the time you've added all the gadgets to it, it's going to look a lot more impressive than that, trust me. So, okay. We are back, people. We are back.
So we're back on the road, and straight away, I let my mum drive.
Say hi.
We went to our next same-name tube stop, the cute farming town of Victoria. There wasn't a lot going on, but, and I'm not making this up, they even had an old steam train sat there from a time we could only assume a railway used to run through here. On the way out, we stopped by the roadside as my mum wanted to look at the farming machine that was automatically watering the crops. And we got a free car wash in the process.
Yeah, don't do that, you probably get wet.
Why?
I think you're going to get wet.
Mind you, we wouldn't have bothered if we'd have known that a few more miles down the road, we were about to get very wet as we were driving into a storm.
Do you want to come off?
Yeah, I think I do. I'm getting a bit scared. Slightly.
We're driving on the interstate and this storm just goes boom and the skies are just black. There's no light and the rain is just tearing down, and then suddenly out of the gloom,
The golden arches of McDonald's have appeared and we're shit scared.
Oh, the arches.
Just so we're gonna take refuge in a McDonald's. Okay, you've got to run for McDonald's.
Okay, have I got to run?
So it's raining. Welcome to Missouri. It's great.
In the morning, with my mum doing the driving, we got to the southern tip of Illinois and the town of Metropolis, which has taken upon itself the mantle of being the metropolis which Superman is based upon, even though it's actually not. Still, you can't say no to a giant statue of Superman in the town square though, can you? Of course not. Instead, we pushed on, eventually making the same name town of Kingsbury in Indiana, which turned out to be a big fat nothing. In fact, Indiana, the whole of it, was a big fat nothing as far as I was concerned. And so we headed west and got to where my mum was going to fly home from, Chicago. But not until we'd hung out in Chicago for the whole weekend and mainly did a lot of travelling on the Chicago subway system. And in case you're wondering, yes, I did look it up. The record for travelling to all 143 stations on the Chicago system is just under 9 hours. I did not attempt it while I was here. The day after my mum flew out of Chicago, I realised I needed to save some money, so instead of staying in a hotel or even camping, I stayed the night sleeping in my car in a truck stop. The morning after, I went to Swiss Cottage, the same name place, that was a museum, except it was a Monday and it was closed. So instead, I had to head south to Kansas and Missouri. I went to Redbridge, which turned out to be a nondescript shopping centre, but then I headed for White City.
To be honest, on the trip so far, there had only been one same-name place that I felt had been really good, and that was early on at Preston in Kentucky. A day of beautiful driving, though, with gorgeous weather, should have maybe been the visual clue. That little did I know that I was about to hit the jackpot of perfect small-town America as I drove towards White City in Kansas.
White City is perfect small-town America. And I got chatting to Roxanne, who runs the local Moonlight liquor store, who told me that there were advantages and disadvantages to living in such a place.
Well, personally for me, the best thing is knowing that people can be very comforting to you in rough periods of time in your life.
Okay.
And they will wave at you down on the street and come to your house.
If you're sick or you're in trouble?
In times of crisis.
Okay.
That's the best. Along with sitting out in your backyard at night in front of a roaring fire in your backyard and seeing the stars in the sky very clearly. Walking down a country road and knowing you're not going to be accosted. Forgetting to lock your doors and knowing that you're safe.
So there's no crime here?
Very little crime.
I like that.
It's not a way of life that I try to sell to anyone. But when you get to be in my stage of life, just living close to nature is comforting and it's healthy. The worst facet that I find in a small town is the gossiping. You know?
So you can't do anything without somebody knowing about it.
Or the fact that everybody I guess their own lives are so dull and boring. You know, they have to get involved in yours. Okay. To feel that they're a part of something. But I have to say, I truly am not involved in that. I'm one of the lucky ones. People all come and trade with me.
So you know all the gossip, but you don't spread it.
I don't know the gossip. They keep me a mushroom. They honestly do. Everybody does. And it's a place, this Moonlight is a place that everyone comes, that they all have to be civil to each other and be decent human beings.
White City even had a railway running through it. Could it be more brilliant?
It's perfect. It's perfect small town America, where everybody knows everybody's name, which, as she said, is sometimes a boon and, I don't know, sometimes not a good thing. It's been the best same name place of the trip so far, and I thoroughly loved it. More, please.
White City had been the best, and I was already sure that I wouldn't find anything else
on the trip that could compete with it. It did seem, though, that wherever I went, I did inadvertently find trains, and as I headed north that night, trying to find somewhere to sleep, I found another railway. I spent the night sleeping in the back of the car parked in a Walmart car park. The next day, I made it to Waterloo, a small town with not a lot going on, and then to Latimer, where I discovered yet another railway.
What actually happened is that I'm in, the sun is low, it's about 7:45 in the evening. I'm in the middle of a cornfield. Look, corn in Iowa. And I'm heading west on Highway 30. And all day I've been like crossing over the railroad without seeing a train. And as I'm driving down to the east, I see across the field in the distance the train running back the other way. And I'm like, I got to get that on video. So I spun the car around, literally, sorry Bev, and shot back. And I'm driving along like looking at the train. And then it had to slow down for a town. And I kind of went through a stop sign and then cut up a side road, and I was desperately trying to get the camera ready so I could kind of nonchalantly kind of like walk on and go, well, here I am at a railroad crossing and there's no train.
This might go on for quite a while. Quite long.
But I got here just as it was getting here and I didn't have time to set the shot up. And so this is me kind of sort of setting the shot up afterwards. Oh look, here comes a train. And then I edit in the bit with, yeah, you get it. Yeah. What I'm thinking is wait for the next train and leave the camera where it is, low down, and like see if the train will go over it. What do you reckon?
After the success of Latimer, Green Park was a letdown. It was a farm in the middle of nowhere, and Elm Park was an even bigger letdown. It was a nothing crossroads in the real middle of nowhere. So I didn't video much for the next few days until my next companion turned up.
Good morning. Hello.
This is Nick, who joined me for 10 days and was more than happy to do some driving and videoing. We cross back over the state line and into northern Nebraska, with farm roads where you see no one else for long periods and the car just kicks up dust. We visited the town of Manoe, where just one person lives. This is Elsie Ehler, who runs a tavern. She declined to be on video, but did let us take photos as she signed my t-shirt, before we headed down more dusty roads towards our campground for the night.
Nick.
So this is camping at a Careway campground in South Dakota at the Badlands. We're in a place where there's no cell phone signal. In fact, we didn't have a cell phone signal for most of yesterday. I couldn't Twitter, nothing. We got to the campground and the internet connection doesn't really work. We are incommunicado. It feels like we're really camping. We're out in the wilderness.
The wilderness just happened to include the nearby Badlands National Park, which was stunning to drive through. And then we dropped in on Waldrug, a weird themed tourist attraction type of town full of gift shops and restaurants. Before we then drove up the road to Mount Rushmore, where a park ranger put me right on the presidents that are actually in the monument.
Well, and Roosevelt was the dude, he was your president during the Second World War, am I correct? And introduced the interstate system?
Well, you're thinking of Franklin Roosevelt, his third cousin.
this is Theodore Roosevelt, who was president from 1901 until 1909.
I didn't know that. I've learned
something.
So
TR came first, and then FDR came along in 1933.
Hang on, so there were two presidents with the same name?
Oh, yeah.
I didn't know that.
Mm-hmm. That's happened a lot through history. We've had two Bushes, two Harrisons. We've had two Adams, John and John Quincy.
Thinking about it, I reckon I'd make a great president.
It's Tuesday, 30th of July. We're at a campground. The campsite wasn't the best. It's more of a fucking holiday camp because there's like 8 million kids and more activities than you can shake a stick at to do. And basically it rained overnight. Oh, before that, more important is that I sliced my thumb open with my penknife. Because we're on a slope, the rain leaked in slightly. My phone is soaking wet and is now saying insert SIM card, even when the SIM card is inserted, so clearly my phone is flooded. We're slightly cold, we're a little bit grumpy, and at 6:40 in the morning, mountain time, we're sat in the car with the heater on, trying to warm up. And I'm trying to take a photo, look over here, I'm trying to take a photo with my camera screwed into my thing, but I can't, it's so heavy. So that's okay, so we've just invented an Oreo rest where you slide the Oreo under the lens and now are you gonna take the photo with the video camera out? Or do two. Like take a picture on the same time. Ready? Ready?
Oh, I was talking.
And that's how we do it. Underground USA style.
Our next same name tube stop they'll be able to get to was in North Dakota and the town of Watford City. But to get there, we had to drive along some very quiet and lonely roads, which I love.
This is US Highway 85. In that direction, North Dakota, about 30 miles on the road. Behind you, South Dakota. Actually, we're in South Dakota, but the village, the town we just came from, about 30 miles behind us. And we came to the plains of Nebraska the other day. It was still quite scenic. There were like farms and stuff around. Suddenly we came out to here, up on this road. Somebody actually tweeted me saying, you wait till you get out of the town on 85, it's 300 miles of nothing. They weren't kidding. There's nothing going on at all. Actually, there's a farm just over there, but you get the idea. This is a major US highway, people. And actually, about 5 minutes before we started taping, a big Walmart truck came by. The truck wasn't going to be from anywhere, it was always going to be from Walmart, wasn't it? You still okay driving?
We get to Watford late when it's dark and everything was closed. So the next morning, we travel west, heading up the Beartooth Pass, a road described as America's scenic highway, and it's only open during the summer months, and it would take us down through to Yellowstone National Park. At 8,000 feet up though, we pull in where Nick spots some wildlife. And the road carries on, climbing higher and higher. The temperature drops and there's snow on the ground.
We're about 11,000 feet up.
It's very pretty.
It's very cold.
Yeah, the temperature. There's the temperature gauge in the car. It's quite funny watching it drop from the 70s down to the 60s and 50s to about 42. And I'm wearing my short sleeve t-shirt. There's like lakes up in the mountains. There's like little miniature lakes within the mountains. Imagine when you wake up in the morning and your duvet is all like crumpled up. And then you spill a cup of coffee amongst your duvet and there's like little pools of... Is that a good analogy? I think that works well. There's actual snow, people, because that's how cold it is up here. There's snow on the ground.
Over the peak, you went to the state of Wyoming and the welcome site of a gas station.
Yeah. We just put up a gas.
$3.15, people, because it's the first gas station. There's a tiny little town called Cook City, little dusty roads, trading post, tavern and casino. Obviously there's a casino, and we were thinking, shit, we hope there's a gas station, because they know that they're the first gas station after like going through this impossibly long, treacherous road. $3.15. That's pricey.
Nick also discovered that they do check to ask if you've bought gas before you can go to the toilet.
I went running in there because obviously I'm about to pee my pants, and asked, went to the back, and it says you had to have a key to get in the bathroom, so I asked for a key. She said, yeah, as soon as you have, I have proof that you've purchased something, you can use the bathroom. And I pointed to the car and I said, he's pumping gas right now, can I have the key? And she stood there and waited to see the thing actually go in the tank before she gave me the key. I'm just standing there, the customer behind me waiting, just standing there. For a porta potty. A porta potty key.
Maybe they'll be a bit more toilet friendly when we get to Yellowstone.
Yay!
Welcome to Yellowstone!
Hello!
$25 to get in for 7 days, and that'll get you into Grand Teton Park as well as Yellowstone now.
The Grand what park?
Grand Teton.
I like it.
And it didn't take long after being in Yellowstone to find something that was being an obstruction.
There are bison on the road. We can't get past. It's just stunning. It's slightly scary because you think, well, what if one of them takes a dislike into you and charges your car?
This is what I meant about camping when you were saying, like, oh, but it's a KOA. I'm like, it does not matter.
And this dude, they're just sat in the road. He's like, I'm just going to walk along. I don't give a shit about you. How much do these weigh? And they're just like, but it's you're like 10 foot from a bison. It must weigh like 500 pounds, right?
Oh. God, way more
than a ton? Pounds. I mean, it's just like, it's amazing.
I am freezing.
Nick's taking pictures out in the sunroof.
This guy right here is shedding his coat. He's losing all his fur.
So we had a weekend off from visiting same name tube towns and explored the magnificence of Yellowstone. It's just stunning, and you can't pass up the opportunity to spend some time there should you find yourself driving through it. You just can't ignore it. Refreshed from our weekend off, though, we cracked on into our next date and to our next stop on the tube map, which is actually a DLR stop.
According to my GPS, I'm half a mile out, 1 minute at 30 miles an hour, away from Poplar, ID, Idaho, which is a slight cheat. For those that are really keeping up, that are in the geek club, because Poplar technically isn't a London Underground stop, it's a DLR, Docklands Light Railway stop. Nick, she's on camera right now, said to me off camera, she went, is this it? Which I think describes perfectly the sheer and utter pointlessness of this quest, sometimes. My TomTom is saying, yes, you're at Poplar. This crossroads is Poplar. There's a dog, get the dog, look at the dog. So typically what I do at this point now is take a photo of something interesting. When I was in Lancaster, in Florida with JJ, it was hard to find something interesting. I'm going to find something hard. What you have to realize is that we were up at the top of Yellowstone Park this morning, and by Wednesday I want to be in Great Falls in Montana to meet my friend Scott, who's driving down from Calgary. And I was going to stay in this campground called Butte, or Butt, B-U-T-T-E. And that was as we left Livingstone at the top of Yellowstone this morning. It said 80 miles. So what we've done is driven 200 miles south to come to a crossroads to drive 200 miles north again tomorrow. Nikki, the environmentalist, it's killing her, the gas that we spent to drive to see this. But at least I can say I've been here.
There were several same name places on the trip where it was just a crossroads with nothing there.
I confess there's nothing here.
spending many hours on the road visiting nothing crossroads and towns kind of meant that we got on each other's nerves a bit, so we needed a bit of cheering up.
And what do you do when you're in Idaho and you're sensible grown-up people who need cheering up? That's right. You go and spend the night in a big wooden dock. We're approaching Cottonwood. I think it's actually Cottonwood Falls. And basically what there is a B&B, bed and breakfast, that is an independently owned B&B. And it's in the shape of a giant beagle, like a dog, a large wooden dog. And we're about 20 minutes out. And it's occurred to us that I didn't actually look up the address. Address? Listen to me. The address of where it was, which is fine, because I figure we're just going to head for Cottonwood, and suddenly on the landscape, on the plains, as you can see here, suddenly this giant dog is just going to suddenly appear. Apparently there's a little baby dog and a little fire hydrant as well for it to pee up against. So that's nice, isn't it? So that's where we're headed. How are you?
Good. Our serious dog says hello. Well, let's crack it.
Hi. I'm Jeff.
Dennis.
The Jeff. Dentist. How do you do? Nice,
nice
to meet you at last.
Nice to meet you.
And this is Nikki. And Francis,
nice,
right?
To meet you.
Yes. And we know all about you because we met your mum today.
We
believe
did.
It or not.
I kid you not.
At the visitor centre on the state line.
At Lolo or Lulu Pass.
Lolo?
Really? Yeah.
So we met your mum.
Oh, cool.
Going camping.
And how did you introduce yourselves?
I was just talking there asking where we were heading. And I said, oh, we're going to be sleeping in a B&B that's a dog. And she's like, the dog park barking. Is it famous around here?
The dog park parking is a little famous around here. After all, how many other B&Bs in the shape of a dog can you name? Dennis introduces me to Sweet Willie.
Now, we built this one, right? We put him up there.
And it was good, right? He was the big dog. He's the world's biggest beagle. We had a sign on him. And we got some media attention. And if some is good, a whole lot more is even better when you're in this kind of business.
I'm going to interject, but why a beagle? Did you used to have a beagle? Because you don't have a beagle now.
They're our best-selling dog, our best-selling carving.
Oh, that you carve. Okay, right.
Carving? Yes, carving's the main business here. The B&B is just on the side for a bit of fun. And here's how they do it, with a chainsaw.
And then I turn my back to you and I split the legs and then I carve here just for an instant to do the tail.
Okay.
Then I take the dog out and the dog will be facing me.
Okay. Now you're not going to do a whole dog here, are you? You're just going to do a quick, okay. But you can knock one of these out in about 5 minutes, you said?
It's so quick, yeah.
What could this be? This is going to be a what?
Labrador retriever.
That'd be a Labrador.
Yeah,
Labrador.
And then Frances would take it with her saw then and finish these sharp edges to be a rounded finished dog. Put the tail on it and put the hip line. And here's one that's would look like.
So if we all blink, ready and blink. Magic. I've just spent the night sleeping in a dog. The joke around these parts is that you've spent the night in a dog house, which is a well-used phrase, I'm sure. My favourite, I think, is the fact that they provide you a game of Dogopoly to play if you like passing away the time. Did you see that there's no parking lot? There's a barking lot. So all the dog related puns came out last night. It's quite a tale to tell.
We headed into Washington State the next day and I dropped Nick off at Seattle. I visited Olympia, a small town, before then heading south and picking up my next companion in Portland.
This is Ashley, who joined me for this leg of the trip, and after the highs of Preston in Kentucky and White City in Kansas, I wasn't convinced that I was going to find another same-named town that was just as good. But we did, down in the depths of the Nevada desert, when we went to Holbon.
We are in the town of Holbon, Nevada. Holbon is a Central Line tube stop in London. One of the very first places that I worked in London, I had to get the tube to Holbon every day, and at this major intersection, shops and cafes and buses and people and noise and dirt and crime and everything. This is the opposite. When I say town of Holbon, follow me, that's a lie, because it's not really a town. It's a railway siding. I swear that when I researched towns in America, although they had tube stop names, I didn't look for a railway angle, I swear. And it amuses me the number of times that I've gone to a place and there has been a railroad or railway nearby. In this case, the town is the railway. We knew we were in trouble when I typed it Holbon into the map, and although it seemed to know where it was, it then went no route available to get there. It said it couldn't find it. We stopped at a gas station and I looked it up, and there's a tiny little thing, and we went down this dusty road that seemed to go on for a while. There was one sign saying it's this way, and then we weren't sure which way it was, and then we stopped at a crossroads, and two guys in a truck pulled up, and one was wearing chaps and the cowboy hat. He's like, we're just moving cattle about. And I was like, where's Holbon? He went, see that over there? That's that junction, that's where it is. And it's proper middle of nowhere stuff, which is a terrible cliche, I know, but when people talk about being in the middle of nowhere, we're in the middle of nowhere. You feel very quiet. Nothing but the breeze, and a fly just went by. Welcome to Holbon.
From the desert of Nevada, we head east into Utah, through Salt Lake City, down through Arsenal on the way, until we get to the mountainous Paradox Valley in search of a place called the Bedrock Store.
And you have to admit, it's quite scenic. Ta-da! And yet again, it's very quiet. What do you make of it, Ashley?
I think it's gorgeous. It is freakishly quiet.
It is freakishly quiet.
I'm really terrified of the falling rock.
Up here. It's not so bad here, but we've turned a couple of corners where there's been a precipice and there's been a finely balanced rock on the edge. And we're thinking, any second now, one of those could come.
You're supposed to listen for a snap and a pop, and if that occurs, you're supposed to duck and cover.
Paradox Valley, people. Somewhere down there is the tiny Bedrock Store, which is what we're headed for to get gas. I'm gonna take some pictures.
Ten more minutes down the road, and we find the store that we're looking for, which also possibly has the oldest petrol pump that I've ever used in my life.
It's pretty cool. There's like nobody else here.
From Utah, we kept heading east, climbing higher through the mountains until we reached the peak at a place called Monarch. We got up to the highest point of the mountains, the Monarch Pass, the Continental Divide. The story goes here that rainwater falling on one side goes west into the Pacific, and rain that falls to the east drains that way towards the Atlantic Ocean instead. So I grabbed a bottle of drink to pour on the floor and see whether it drained to the west or the east.
Only for this whole section, we didn't switch the mic on, so there's actually no sound for this dramatic moment that my drink hits the ground and we see in which direction it goes. A new state, Texas, beckoned, as did a new companion. Farewell, Ashley. Hello, Paul.
Hello. Look, you're on camera. This is Paul.
Yeah.
That's Ashley. This is Paul.
Come on in.
Yes, we'd made our way to Amarillo in Texas, going via Stratford on the way, where Ashley flew home and Paul then became my new companion for the final leg. If there's one thing that Paul knows how to do, it's how to light a fire.
Iron Man. I make fire.
Staying at KOA campgrounds had become a way of life, as had visiting other offbeat tourist attractions, such as the Four Corners Monument, where you can put your hands and feet into four states at the same time. Leaving Texas behind, we popped into Warren for Warren Street in Oklahoma, and then headed west and picked up Angel Fire for Angel in New Mexico. We took a brief diversion via Utah, and then found ourselves in the amazing red desert here of Arizona, and eventually getting back onto Route 66. Out of the desert, and we visited London Bridge in Arizona. That's the original London Bridge, which they moved over brick by brick from London to the USA. From there, we had to head for Las Vegas as a kind of a, I have to go and see Las Vegas. But on the way, we decided to go and find an abandoned phone booth in the middle of the desert.
We're in the middle of the Mojave Desert. We were doing fine. We were doing fine whilst... all the whilst we were on the paved highway following the tom-tom, and suddenly we missed out turning. There's this little dusty road. The dusty road turned into sandy road, turned into gravel road, turned into rock road, turned into this overgrown road, and we kind of had to go up this rocky embankment, and we've come out here to what appears to be some sort of mine or something in the middle of... we need to have a better phrase than middle of nowhere. This is real middle of nowhere, and we're on a quarter tank of gas, and the tom-tom doesn't know where we are. But there's a sign here saying SEMA Road, we're going to go and follow that, and we might die here, people, in the middle of nowhere, all to find an abandoned phone booth. Cool.
As Jeff said, we're in the middle of nowhere. Tom doesn't know where we are. It's in the middle of the Mojave Desert. So, firstly, to the rescuers, we didn't suffer. It's our own fault. You know, there's no liability. The insurance documents for me are in the back of the car. Graham, I love you. Look after the cats. And as part of my will, you got the house. The one next door, though, goes to... I don't know, give it away. Give it to charity. And everything else, yeah, we enjoyed ourselves.
The reason why we're scaring ourselves slightly... this concrete patch is famous. In 1997, when the internet was just getting off the ground, when 28K modems were their forte, some dude that lived in Las Vegas was just looking at like a map of the area and saw this tiny phone symbol on a map in the middle of the Mojave Desert. And he's like, what the hell is there a phone box doing there? And he drove out on a different road to which we drove in today and found that there was indeed a phone booth here. Cut a long story short, he published the number on a website. The website became a cult hit website. We'll link to the website. People came here as like a pilgrimage to visit the phone box. Other people rang the number to see if anybody would answer it. Some guy said that he'd had, you know, words in his head, word from God, to come here and camped here for a whole month just answering phone calls. In the end, the phone company, I think Pacific Bell, took it away because so many people people coming out here to visit it. But there's a whole website about it, the original Mojave Desert phone booth website. In 2006, independent film production company in Hollywood actually made an independent movie about the phone booth and people that travelled to it. Go put that on your Netflix queue, people. But we've driven out into the desert. What are these trees? Are they trees or are they just kind of like cacti trees? They're fantastic. Hello, we're in the middle of the desert. Maybe you won't starve to death because we'll eat these green and yellow things. Maybe that'll.
They are melons.
We survived the desert, spent the weekend in Las Vegas, and then headed for our last place in California, knowing that that would bring the journey to an end.
Today is the last day we're in the town of Ridgecrest in California. We left Las Vegas yesterday. We came through Death Valley and got buzzed by some F-15 US Air Force fighter jets. Came through the town. When we left Las Vegas yesterday, I turned on the radio in an extreme moment of serendipity that the one record which they joke about that you hear on Midwest radio stations in the USA every time, that being Eagles Hotel California, came on the radio as we left California. It was a sign that we should stay in a hotel rather than camp. I'm disappointed I haven't got more footage of KOA campgrounds that I've spent the majority of my time over the summer camping in KOA campgrounds. But instead, this is what we have to do. Every time we fucking stay somewhere now, the monitor has to come in, and the box of video equipment has to come in, and this bag of equipment has to come in, and I have to carry the whole PC in, and my clothes are a mess, and I haven't washed my clothes in a week, and it's just every time you have to fucking load and unload the car, and it just becomes just an effort. I'm being very grouchy, because I'm very irritable about the whole, about just being on the fucking road all the fucking time, and just fed up with having shit that falls about the car when you turn the corner or go over a road bump, or just driving every fucking day and buying gas every day and continually being thirsty and going to the toilet and wondering where you're going to stay and working and uploading photos and videos and do I sound like I haven't enjoyed myself?
It's a 3-hour drive to my last stop and I'm feeling tired and philosophical.
How many miles have we driven?
Today.
Today, with you, the whole trip, ever in my entire life, how many miles have I driven since 20 years ago? We're in LA, it's hot. We're 4.2 miles away from Hyde Park Boulevard. There's Hyde Park Boulevard, west and east. It's not even a proper town or city, but it is a named place in the suburbs of Santa Monica and Los Angeles as a community known as Hyde Park. It's not an actual park. If you had images of us sort of skipping gaily through the daisies in a park, you know, and a big sign saying welcome to Hyde Park and me going, what do you think the final Twitter should say?
Hyde Parked Up.
Hyde Parked Up?
Yes. Suitably now.
No, I like where you're going with the puns.
Trouble is, when you've seen the beauty of a small town and the deserts and mountains of America, a suburban street feels like an anticlimax.
So I guess we can go now. We're going to go and stay at my friend's house, Tatiana. Should we go and meet her?
Yeah, I reckon. There's not a lot here.
She's not a lot here.
I reckon it's...
She has a swimming pool and a fridge with a beer in it with my name on.
Go for it. You should be in luck to her.
Are we being looked at?
Yeah.
All right, then put the camera down.
I'd spent 73 days on the road and driven 18,763 miles. That's 257 miles, on average, 4 hours driving every day. I'd been to all 48 mainland states of America, taken 6 companions with me, stayed at 35 campgrounds, taken over 3,000 photos and uploaded over 20 video highlights to my blog as I went. There were highs and lows, but mainly highs, and an unforgettable take on what's out there in the USA. Maybe more than most Americans will ever see of their own country in their lifetime. I wanted to speak to one of those Americans because I felt like Hyde Park hadn't been the best ending to it all. And so 2 weeks later, when back in Charleston, as I was preparing to leave to go home to England, I caught up with my friend Dan. Dan, who had orchestrated the raising of the money to enable me to buy my new equipment when everything had got stolen and get my road trip going again. And he asked me to reflect on my summer.
So there was a slight feeling of, there was a slight anticlimactic feeling.
I asked you at the time if you'd ever read a couple of books. Do you remember what they were?
Steinbeck, but not Grapes of Wrath.
No.
Another Steinbeck.
Travels with Charlie. And the other one was On the Road. I asked you about
that. I've yet to go to the library. I promise I'll go to the library this afternoon after this interview and check those babies out. How about that?
So the point was that there's this great tradition in American literature of people who experience what you said, was that the country's so enormously big.
Yeah.
And people who want to go out there and try to understand the country have traveled around it and done all these things, and they all seem to have a very similar point. They get to the end of they get to the end of the land, and they're like, just kind of exhausted, and there's this almost resignation that it's just too big.
Yes. I mean, people say that Charleston and South, actually Charleston isn't the South, South Carolina is the South, but you can tell the difference between South Carolina and like Alabama and Arkansas.
Yes, you can.
So,
and now you know the difference.
Louisiana's okay. I'm not just saying that because of Tammy, but Mississippi, Arkansas, and Alabama are proper, proper deep South. Oh my goodness.
There's a term I like called the rough South. There's a whole series of, there's a whole literary genre called rough South fiction that's...
So Montana and North Dakota are pretty, but I just know that during the winter I wouldn't be saying that.
You wouldn't.
So give me the mountains of Colorado mixed with the desert of Arizona, with the beauty of northern New Mexico, and there may just be the perfect place in America there. Right. How about that?
Did you go to Chicago?
Yeah, I like Chicago.
Did you go through Iowa?
How about this? Pick up Chicago. And put it on Four Corners. If you could place Chicago on top of Four Corners and then base the city. And then, because what I always said I liked about London, when I lived in London, I lived on the suburbs. Sort of, if I wanted city, I could head north for 10 miles and go and be city boy. If I wanted countryside, I could head, and the coast was nearby. So you could live in Chicago, which is just sort of eclectic, multi, kind of cool place with the city and suburbs and stuff. And then on the one side, you'd have the Colorado Mountains, and on the other side, have the Arizona Desert. I think I'd be happy there.
Yeah, that'd be
good. Let's put Chicago on Four Corners. That's it. That's what my road trip has taught me. So thanks very much.
Well, you're welcome.
Very much. There, yeah, I knew you were going to say that. Yeah, that was fun. Edit.
Do I get to say cut now?
Cut now.